Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week we return to Lilli Palmer. This is part 8 of the Acteurist Oeuvre-view, The Long Dark Hall, and The Four Poster, a couple of films from the early 1950s in which she co-starred with her then-husband, Rex Harrison. After those discussions are done, please stay tuned. We've got an epic Fear and Moviegoing log to go through. We saw 5 movies during the past week. These were all part of the Alone in the Arena series TIFF Cinematheque is running. We saw Rounders by John Dahl, When We Were Kings, a documentary about the Ali Foreman rumble in the jungle, Spike Lee's He Got Game, Martin Scorsese's The Color of Money, and Oliver Stone's Any Given Sunday. So please do join us for those. We'll be going chronologically, as always, with our Lilli Palmer films. We'll start out with Leonard Maltin's take on The Long Dark Hall from 1951. Very terse, as Maltin often is. He gives it 2.5 stars out of 4. Sturdy melodrama of man accused of killing girlfriend, with wife remaining loyal to him. Directors, there were 2 of them, Anthony Bushell, who's also an actor, and Reginald Beck. Cast list, Rex Harrison, Lilli Palmer, Tanya Held, Henrietta Barry.
So we should probably preface our discussion of these films by talking again about the circumstances that Rex Harrison and Lilli Palmer were in. Given the content of the films, it seems valid to bring this up again, particularly this first film.
So from Change Lobsters and Dance, which is Lilli Palmer's autobiography, I got a decent sense of the chaos that overtook their lives in the late 1940s after philandering husband Rex. Well, he engaged in multiple affairs, but one of them ended in the suicide of Carol Landis, a popular Hollywood actress of the mid-1940s, and the press just went crazy with it.
Everything I've read, but without giving me a source, says that he delayed calling the police for several hours after finding her body the morning after they'd spent the night together. The Landis family apparently believes that Rex Harrison killed her to avoid the scandal of their affair coming out, which to me makes absolutely no sense. This is like a much bigger scandal that she ended up dead and the affair came out anyway.
Sounds pretty crazy.
Also, she had had multiple suicide attempts before this. Oh yeah, that's where we saw that in a movie recently, The Hustler. Seems like she was gonna go eventually, one way or another, but the cruelty of Rex Harrison is what did it.
Lilli Palmer did, in fact, stick with the marriage, and she talks a fair bit about that in the autobiography. It was grueling. The little section in the center of the paperback with a bunch of photos in it, there are images from the time splashed all over the front page with Lilli and Rex at the funeral, you know, people taking photos of them. They just look so miserable. And Hollywood wanted nothing to do with them, at least for a couple of years. They found themselves in England making The Long Dark Hall.
Yeah, this was a British film, although scripted by Nunnally Johnson.
A person that they must have gotten to know at Fox. I mean, he was a Fox stalwart.
But then The Four Poster is a Columbia Pictures film.
Yeah, well, that's a Stanley Kramer production. It seems kind of like a Maverick thing.
The Long Dark Hall in particular seems, I don't know if she talks about their film choices at this time, but this seems like an attempt to simultaneously capitalize on the scandal and save Rex Harrison's career.
She doesn't go into it a lot. She talks more about The Four Poster. This one, you could see, hey, I mean, they've already paid the price, so why not make a movie out of it and see if that brings them blocking to the cinemas.
And if that was the idea, and also to save Harrison's career, the husband comes off very badly in this film, but the fact that the wife sticks by him through everything, even as it progressively comes out more and more how sleazy this affair was, and the depth of his betrayal, the fact that she never wavers in her support of him, and her pointing out repeatedly, whatever he's done, he didn't kill anybody. So it seems like that would kind of do the trick, because Harrison is simultaneously doing public penance in this role, owning up to his bad behavior and sort of being redeemed.
You're gonna exile him from Hollywood for life for this? Come on, people, he didn't kill anyone. It's not like he killed someone. Obviously it worked. He certainly had a long career ahead of him in films and Oscars.
Lilli Palmer eventually, and not too long after this, eventually recovered her dignity by leaving him, but this is a real blow to her dignity, taking on this role.
Yeah, it's really palpable in the autobiography. Of course, it all winds up being kind of a triumph for her. I mean, she does seem to have been very much in love with Carlos Thompson, whom she married in the late 1950s, and she did stay friends with Rex Harrison. She sounds like she got everything that she needed and wanted out of life once she got through this horrible patch.
And to judge from the distribution of his ashes, it seems that she had a special place in his heart for the rest of his life.
He would talk to her in great detail about all of the travails and troubles he was experiencing with other women later on, and she did help him.
I can understand if you had truly had a friendship-based marriage. I can understand sticking through a lot, but not everything, together.
And of course, the way she puts it in the movie, it's like, well, I don't even have a rival anymore. She's dead. Of course I'm gonna stick by him. One problem I guess I had with this movie is that the real Rex Harrison, yeah, he's a pretty charming guy. He's a very talented person. You could see how Lilli Palmer could talk herself into sticking it out through all of this. This movie doesn't really give us enough, I don't think.
It makes this couple nothing like this couple of charming, sophisticated, continental intellectuals that were Lilli Palmer and Rex Harrison having a difficult but sophisticated marriage. This is just a suburban couple.
And this Rex Harrison, he's not charming at all. It's kind of a brave performance in a way, because it strips away all of the things that he kind of does better maybe than anyone and leaves him just alternately crying and ranting bore.
Something I was reading about in his Wikipedia page is that collaborators would sometimes accuse him of coasting on charm and not being as much of a complete asshole as he should be in his roles, particularly in a role that was based on him. In this film, yeah, as you say, there is no coasting on charm.
Absolutely none. He is really vulnerable in this movie, really uncharming.
There are moments, like the moment after he's found the showgirl's body and goes back to his home and he's trying to appear semi-normal to his wife, who doesn't even know he's having an affair, let alone that he just found it, the woman dead. When he goes into the kitchen, splashing the water in his face, he's just a complete noir wreck. And I was very impressed by the method acting of Rex Harrison at that moment.
I'm not trying to diminish the movie by talking about the character's lack of charm. I think it's a plus. I would have been far more bored by a film that gave us the real Rex Harrison on the stand trying to defend himself. This is a desperate, pathetic man with none of the panache of his character from Unfaithfully Yours or something
true.
Like that, right?
True, true. Who's probably more like our real Rex Harrison. Yeah, what an irony that he had just played such a charming but totally unlikable character who fantasizes about murdering his wife right before the death of Carol Landis.
And was just driven into jealous rages and all of the things that this character also apparently was, but he's supposed to be so harmless. And you kind of believe it. I mean, he's just too pathetic for words in this movie.
Well, let's talk about the most interesting aspect of this sturdy melodrama, other than the lurid real life connections, is the peeling back of the onion layers of this pathetic man. So let's talk about how that unfolds.
He's got a reputation around town as a solid family man with his peers and with his wife as well. When he tries to explain how he ever got into this relationship with this woman, a showgirl played by Patricia Wayne, who was in Your Witness, Robert Montgomery movie. I thought she was really good in her brief appearance in the film. I mean, it's also a serial killer narrative, which we didn't mention at all until now.
That's how the whole thing starts out, that the serial killer has decided basically he is the audience, the Americans who are baying for the blood of the real life Rex Harrison, who just sees that this married man is engaged in this illicit affair and hates how immoral it is, and he's going to punish the parties to it.
The first scene, this guy just comes out of nowhere and it seems like, okay, well, is this gonna be a Jack the Ripper type story? And
that's what it's film to look like.
And the guy just looks absolutely insane. He is, of course. I never expected him to be hanging out at the court, insinuating himself into the life of Lilli Palmer, and actually have him not be a danger to her, because he really does stick rigidly to his insane moralism, which empowers him to go out there and slaughter these women who might be luring family men into illicit relationships.
But the family men are also his target, that they're going to end up in prison for his crime.
Well, no, that only happens to Rex Harrison. He's not doing that in general. He's really going after these women and blaming them, but he falls in love, such as his love is, with Lilli Palmer.
Yeah.
So, of course, yeah, then he wants to see Rex Harrison go away.
He is fascinated by this wronged wife.
Why not? She's great. She's Lilli Palmer.
The most interesting, well, one of the most interesting elements of the film is this obsession that he develops with the wife. This is not something you see too often in serial killer narratives.
No, I don't think I've ever seen anything like this.
Yeah.
He just switches it on and off to some extent. I mean, he's still a weirdo with her.
And Palmer's best scene is the scene that they have together, where she's gradually realizing just how crazy this man is.
Well, she doesn't realize how crazy. She still doesn't think he's going around killing people.
True, well, but she starts realizing that he's crazy.
She treats him like an obsessed fan and wants him out of there, and I don't blame her. But yeah, the movie gets some very interesting tension out of the times that he's at her house. He doesn't intend to threaten her no matter what she says, but he's also very overbearing and freakish. And
well, and he really, really, really wants to be her friend.
Yeah, but then when she says, no, you're not going to be my friend, he's like, okay, you'll never hear from me again. I'm sorry. And he slinks away. But he does give himself away by talking too much at the trial, explaining that no one will ever catch the real killer because it could be anyone that happened to see the showgirls, and probably he's just stalking the streets thinking of himself as an instrument of justice. And he just can't resist using the same turn of phrase when he writes to the newspaper.
Really gives him a hard-on, that turn of phrase. Instrument of justice.
Really good cast in this movie. Raymond Huntley plays the inspector, stage's first Dracula. And we've seen him before on our podcast. He is the German agent in I See a Dark Stranger. I like that actor a lot. He's very sympathetic in this movie. A policeman who, thankfully, is paying very close attention to everything going on. Otherwise, Rex Harrison would have been executed. It's also an anti-capital punishment film. The film makes a huge point out of the fact that the only reason Rex Harrison's still alive to be cleared when they get this letter is that House of Commons had passed new laws eliminating the death penalty.
Right, and he's been convicted on circumstantial evidence.
His execution day arrives, and he would have been sent to the scaffold or whatever they were doing at the time, electrocuted, I don't know. It's so expected that the Jack the Ripper guy sends his letter in as soon as the day has come, and he hasn't been reading the newspaper.
But back to the onion layers, Harrison's character being put on stand, groom.
Yeah, well, he tries to explain his motivations, and he starts out by insisting on his mission to put this woman on the righteous path.
And you kind of almost buy that that is part of his motivation. There's no reason that couldn't go along with the rest of it.
No, I'm sure it's true, but it's obviously more than that. It's not just about getting her off the bottle.
Right. He also says that the only reason he didn't want her going out with other men was because they would be a bad influence. He also, when asked why he was in these nightclubs or wherever where he met her originally, he said he just wanted a change of pace, a little bit of bohemian color, whereas clearly he's going out to find showgirls to sleep with. This is probably not his first showgirl.
But I'm sure it is true, as he says, that they would meet at a cafe or bar, but then he would try to get her to go home with him and stop drinking all night. Go back to her place, obviously, or some other place of assignation.
Eventually, when her letters that he thought were destroyed, like an idiot, when they are brought out in court, it is revealed that he, as he says, that he was obsessed with her.
That's what you want me to admit? Fine, fine.
She was an obsession. He has told his wife, I mean, now we're getting into Lost Highway territory, because he has told his wife that he doesn't have the capability to commit an act of violence, that he doesn't even think of such solutions. He doesn't even formulate them in his mind.
That must have been a reply to the Landis family.
But then it comes out that he's been having these jealous rages and threatening violence to this girl. To me, I don't see any very clear, firm boundary between somebody who threatens violence and somebody who commits violence. I don't think there is a very stable boundary.
The movie asks us to believe, and we do, I think, believe it because of how ineffectual and sad he is.
But he has been threatening to kill her.
Right, because he can't think of any other thing to say to her that might stop her from drinking.
I guess if someone's enough of a maniac to threaten to kill somebody, they're probably the kind of person who might do it. But we're asked to believe not.
Yeah, in the world of the film, there is a sharp distinction. And everyone does agree. Yeah, he yelled a lot, but he never did anything about it.
No, he's never raised a hand against her.
The showgirl's best friend, and we spend a fair bit of time with her at different points of the film, she doesn't like Mr. Groom, but she's pretty firm on that point, that no, he never touched her in any way.
I guess, come to think of it, in my own life experience, I have known people who threaten violence to other people and have not actually killed anybody.
I hope so, because there's a lot of people that say, I'm going to kill you for one reason or another, and most of them don't do it.
No, I don't mean jokingly. I mean people who have actually threatened violence. I guess I have known maniacs like that, but who, like, never have actually killed anybody. I'm not sure if I'd go so far as to say that they've never assaulted anybody, but never murdered anybody, to my knowledge, so... Yeah, I guess that can actually happen.
There are such people. It's a very interesting combination of different types of film, because it has that moody, noirish serial killer beginning, and intermittently thereafter, it's got this domestic drama. It's a courtroom film as well. There's quite a bit that takes place in the courtroom.
And they keep calling him out for being a liar. He just keeps lying over and over and over again, always to spare the feelings of his wife.
It almost seems like a public service announcement in some ways, right? Because Raymond Huntley, again, the detective, he knows what's going on from the beginning. He doesn't think that Rex Harrison is the murderer, but kind of forced to assume it must be him because there's no other possibility that presents itself. But he tells Rex Harrison, you don't have to make a statement, you know, when I just brought you in. Your wife is sitting right next to us. Don't tell us anything right now. We'll extract this from you later. But Rex Harrison insists. Haven't been in that part of town for more than a year. I don't know this person.
And the real life Rex Harrison apparently, well, also was saying things like, I was just good friends initially with Carol Landis. Of course, every time a new depth of sordidness to this relationship is revealed in court, you're expecting the wife to be shaken in her faith, but she never is. He loves me, and he didn't kill anyone, and that's all she cares about. That's it.
I think there are some excellent nuances to her portrayal, because it's not like she is...
Well, I don't think Palmer has the ability to... She just isn't the type that is usually cast in this role. She doesn't have the ability to portray overweening virtue.
Yeah, it's not a saccharine stand-by-your-man performance.
But she never wavers in standing by him, including when her parents tell her that he's betrayed her. She's like, he has never betrayed me. I mean, it's awful. The dialogue is awful.
She's very good at conveying low-key melancholy, and that's in there as well. I can't really think of a better person to do the job that was entrusted to her in this film.
Which is?
Well, what we've been talking about, which is to believably portray a woman who has been severely disappointed by her husband's behavior without losing her love for him.
But we're made to feel like, I mean, we understand these gender tropes, so the movie doesn't even have to spend any time at all on them. We understand already how she feels when they start talking about the jealous rages, and he starts talking about how this woman was an obsession. We know that she understands that men are just like this, and men will just develop these sordid obsessions with these sordid women, and it doesn't have anything to do with feelings for her or their children or their home life. It's just men.
Yeah, there's no one ever says anything like that, but you're right, it has to be part of the assumed cultural architectonics of the plot.
The most offensive part of the movie is his return to the white picket fence home and her run out from it toward him for their embrace, because the last thing that you can possibly believe watching this movie is that this couple is going to live happily ever after.
I don't know if it asks you to believe that.
Of course it asks you to believe that. That ending asks you to believe that. Of course it does. That is the ultimate closure ending. So much so that, of course, it ends up subverting itself.
I think you're right about that. But on the other hand, the way he achieves his release from prison is so harrowing. I mean, he comes right to the point of being executed. You can excuse her for being happy to see him still alive, at least for a few minutes, before she starts not feeling so great about their marriage again.
Has this man, can he possibly have been completely scared back onto the straight and narrow? And if so, where are all these sordid desires going to go? What is the future here?
Well, channel them back into his marriage. I do believe this version of Rex Harrison, what this character has been through, probably is enough to make him swear off showgirls for life.
Right. But the real life Rex Harrison never was scared by the death penalty, so he just kept going.
He kept going.
Living his best life.
All right, the four poster. Malton says, Jeanne de Hartog play is tour de force for stars who enact various phases of married couples' life. Warm, witty script. Superb performances enhanced by ingenious animated interludes by the UPA studio. Later became the stage musical I Do! Exclamation points twice. The cast list, Rex Harrison and Lilli Palmer, that's it. Director, Irving Reese. 3.5 stars out of a possible 4.
So this movie, or this play it was based on, premiered in 1950, originally ran in the West End in London.
And did they originate the roles?
No. Then there was a Broadway production. So the first cast of the Broadway production, however, was Hume Cronin and Jessica Tandy. So I guess when possible to get a real life acting couple to play these parts was a coup.
Makes perfect sense.
That would have been something to see. They seem to have a very different marriage than Rex Harrison's and Lilli Palmer's, however, so that would bring a very different flavor. Like, that actually was a devoted couple.
Well, I think so. I've never read in much detail about them, but I know in the 80s and 90s, everyone was always talking about this wonderful old married couple.
My impression was that they were, you know, married to the end of their lives.
No, they were, yeah.
Yeah, so from 1942 to Jessica Tandy's death in 1994.
Yeah, there was an awful lot of talk about that around the Driving Miss Daisy period.
I didn't love this play. It was a bit morbid and hysterical. I didn't love it. It was interesting, and they certainly have an incredible rapport.
I loved their performances. Yeah. I'm not going to say I would love the play no matter who was in it or anything like that. And there are things to quibble with in the way it presents the marriage and the story it wants to tell, but I thought it was a mesmerizing film to watch because of them.
It's a two-hander, which means it's an acting tour de force, and it's a tour de force of chemistry, right?
It takes the long view on this marriage. Like the longest possible view from the day that they are wed to after the death of the wife, played by Lilli Palmer, Abby. She comes back to keep it a two-hander by being a ghost or a dream figure.
Apparently the American version of the ending did not involve her death.
Oh, really?
So this is the British version.
Well, thank God.
It was softened for Broadway.
That's ridiculous. I mean, what, nobody ever dies? Or do they die together somehow at the age of 100?
I don't know.
Yeah, that sounds like garbage.
That said, the scene where, that's maybe the most intense scene in the whole film, the scene where all of a sudden he's smashing the glass out of her hand because he's tried to poison her.
Yeah, he's trying to do like a mercy killing and then kill himself.
Because she's going to go and because he can't write anymore? Yeah, that was unexpected because it had, up until then, it had seemed like a light-hearted, warm-hearted, I mean, yes, there's the death of their son.
In World War One.
But that's something you see more frequently in films of this era than murder-suicide of husband and wife. So the movie and the marriage begins with their first night together as a married couple in a house owned by her father as tenants.
Their families are well-to-do. They've got a lot of social capital.
But they're starting out just living in this little apartment.
I would take it.
The four poster is the present that Rex Harrison has made for her. The four poster bed. There's this whole dance around, almost literally a dance around this bed. The trope of the woman who is terrified of her wedding night, not simply because of the physical fact that she's a virgin, but because as eventually it's said between them that it means her girlhood is over, she's going to transform into a whole new phase of life. The loss of virginity gives that a kind of rite of passage character for her that is not present for the man.
Well, it's also taken for granted he's had sex many times before. That's culturally accepted.
Right.
And she asks him, you know, have you had any lovers in the past? And he's reluctant to talk about such things, but it's pretty clear. He's also been singing that song, the French song, talking about auprès de ma blonde.
It all means the same thing, which is that virginity for a woman is set at a much higher value.
Of course, and that seal is only to be removed on this high-stakes wedding night.
I really love the way they play that moment of getting to what the real issue is when he says, oh, of course, your youth is over. And she gets really upset about that, comically upset about that. How can you say that? How can you say my youth is over, or my girlhood, or whatever it is?
Yeah.
It's like a terrifying prospect for her, but it's played comically. I think my favorite moment in this scene from Rex Harrison is when he very casually describes how he's not cut out to be a school teacher.
But that's the job that his social network has provided for him, so he's going to have to do it, at least for a little while.
Beginning with the problem being administrative tedium and problems with authority, but ending with just not giving a fig about the virtue of the boys.
He's not going to be Mr. Chips.
Fits very well with Harrison's persona.
Charmingly sneering at most of humanity. The relationship with Lilli Palmer anchors him in many ways and enables him to have a variety of emotions.
We next see them at the point of her first pregnancy.
He develops sympathetic childbearing pains. He's bedridden and complaining of all kinds of maladies and headaches.
And he is facing the complete rejection of his first literary work, his book of poems.
Right, which he had been yelling to her on their wedding night in exalted Whitmanian frenzy. But nobody gets it. Nobody understands what he's trying to do.
Too modernist.
And so Lilli Palmer convinces him that he should write a narrative, maybe based on something that he understands from experience. And he's like, you're going to have me writing Little Women.
Mr. Louisa May Alcott.
Yeah, it was pretty funny.
And they call each other idiots in a variety of elaborate ways. We already understand that the trope is going to be that this wife who doesn't work nevertheless is going to give him good advice and shape his career and help him become a genius.
That's the idea here.
This is a Kunstler roman of a sort, but it's not a Bildungs roman because it takes him his entire life to finally become this genius whose potential she originally saw.
Yeah, he really doesn't enter his major phase until after her death, I guess.
Yeah, we next see him having achieved success but not genius by following her advice and starting to write about their lives.
Very trite novel titles that amuse the hoi polloi, and he has to go on book signing tours and placate the bovine masses.
He's also developed, I guess, a young female following, or just his general literary celebrity has enabled him to attract young women.
It's always a danger for someone of Rex Harrison's cast of mind, someone that has his narcissistic qualities.
His wife is finding him increasingly insufferable, and so he's also turning to these more impressionable young women.
Although it sounds like he only really had one affair.
You know, it's that kind of flexible movie talk or maybe also play talk, I don't know, of the period where you can imagine anything. You can imagine he didn't even sleep with this young girl,
right,
just flirted with her, or you can imagine that he had a full affair with her and only her, or you can imagine that he had a dozen affairs. It's all left open.
Yeah, you're right.
All we know is that later on, when the wife develops an infatuation, that we're not to believe that she acted on it.
No, of course not.
But yeah, so this becomes another tour de force scene. They actually get to the point of a violent fight. Well, she's violent with him. She punches him in the stomach.
She does, gut punch.
After she tries to make him jealous, and then he kisses her, and he realizes from her reaction that no, she still only loves him, and then she punches him in the gut.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. What he's done is so patronizing. And every time he goes for that move, it just makes her angrier and angrier. Because she does still, for whatever reason, feel this passion for him. You can see why she might want to punch him at that point.
And she does!
Since he's not going to change his behavior, or doesn't seem like he's going to.
But then she feels, once he stops demanding entry back into the room, then she's unhappy that he's actually gone away. But it's fine because he comes back through the window.
Oh yeah, he's soaking wet.
And they have to do a reprisal of their wedding night, where once again he has to seduce her and convince her to spend the night with him in the bed. And he does this through reading to her, reading his new book.
Which is an advance in his technique and skills.
And he doesn't think that the young fan can help him out as much as she can with this, so he flatters her intellect, but also flatters her on another level because the heroine of the novel is based on her.
Yeah, it's a description of Lilli Palmer. But after that point, I mean, she does become genuinely fed up of him, right? That's when we get into the flapper era. And they go through, there's some makeup, obviously, in this film, but not as much on her. I mean, she's really doing most of the age progression through...
Well, it's a little bit like Heaven Can Wait, in that only in her final illness are they putting some old age makeup on her. And not very old age makeup, old age like we're old.
But she does do a great job, I think, of conveying a progression in the character. She really seems like a young girl in the first scene.
Sure, yeah.
And she's, of course, not. I mean, she's just about 40.
And then she's a soon-to-be mother who, there's like that close-up camera shot of her. She goes into her labor pains and she experiences some kind of elevation to sainthood. You know, the expression of beatitude on her face as she experiences the labor pains.
That sequence where she's ready to leave him.
For this young man, this young poet.
She's not angry at Rex Harrison anymore.
Well, I mean, part of what's happened, and again, just as he did in the first scene, he diagnoses and articulates what's going on with her, right? So in this case, he says, your role as a mother is done. You believe your job is done, and you can't think of anything but to go back to your youth, to be young again. This is more reductionist, though, than his first diagnosis.
Well, it is, but it's saved by the fact that it's also an analysis of his own behavior, right? I mean, of middle-age crisis in general.
Right.
Now, is it 100% correct? Is it fair to reduce her emotions to that? Maybe not. But she decides that it probably is true that she doesn't have any real concrete feelings for this young poet that she's taken a fancy to, and it's just a symptom of something else.
Well, she has lost her son.
Well, yeah, but that happened quite a bit before this.
True, but I think from that scene, we're supposed to imagine that it has left a lasting impact on her.
I do think it's really significant, though, that if they're both dealing with middle age crisis, the movie, as we've said, implies that he does go through with it probably at least once and maybe multiple times with various crushes and infatuations and affairs. For her, it would be a much bigger thing, a much greater transgression if she did act on it. It's one thing for the wish to be there and for Rex Harrison to identify it, but it's kind of like it's saving her from doing something that would be just shocking for a woman to leave her husband and go hang out with a 20-year-old poet.
The movie at various points flirts with feminism without ever taking that as an option, including the point where she's ready to leave him because of his affair. And this, it's doing it here again and relating it to the jazz era of a certain kind of women's liberation.
She's saying all the right things before Rex Harrison gets out his psychologist handbook. She's saying, you know, I've been reduced to all these roles and I'm not an authentic human being. I have never been allowed to be one, and I'm gonna go do that now. And he says, no, that's not even what you're really doing. You just want to recapture your youth.
Maybe one of the more unsettling things about this scene, and the more interesting things, is the way it's played and the way it's directed by Irving Reese. I don't feel like her own articulation of what's going on with her is fully dismissed or that his is fully endorsed.
No, I agree.
So she doesn't choose this option of behaving scandalously, but that doesn't necessarily mean that the needs that are articulated are ever addressed in the marriage.
No, they clearly aren't, because she just goes on being his best audience and critic and muse until she dies.
Yeah, and I mean, maybe it's actually the fact that that doesn't feel fully satisfactory, maybe that's actually a strength of the movie.
Well, I think so. I don't think that it's saying this is how things should be. It's saying this is how a believable marriage of a novelist and intelligent woman of the early 20th century could have gone.
It's a good enough marriage, but it's not...
It's not what we want.
It's not ideal.
No.
Yeah. It's supposed to be. It's supposed to be about compromises, and definitely it is written to show that the woman made more compromises than the man did.
Yeah. And then, for her troubles, she gets a terminal disease and dies much earlier than him. It's not right.
I mean, it is kind of. It does feel like a variation, except that more evenly weighted in the roles of husband and wife, and therefore more of a marriage movie. It does feel like a variation on Heaven Can Wait.
Sadly, Lubitsch didn't live to see this.
We've talked about in the past, or I've definitely brought up, raised the question of what would count as being a marriage movie, not just a movie that's about the typical trials and tribulations of a marriage of a given period, but something that really examines the concept of marriage as more of a emotional, spiritual thing between two people.
I do think that it does have to be viewed through a historical lens as well, right? So it would have to be an examination of that type of relationship in a specific place at a specific time. It's not a trans-historical concept, marriage.
No, but I think it has to, for it to qualify for a marriage movie in the sense that I'm going for, that spiritual bond in the midst of all of these sociological elements, it has to be invested in and examining that, right?
Well, this one certainly is.
Yeah, and we've only found a very few marriage movies of that kind, and we thought the Claudia and David movies were very good for that as well. But this, I ended up not liking it so much, and feeling that it was very morbid, but as we discuss it, I feel more like it's supposed to be sad, this movie.
Well, of course it's supposed to be
sad. It's supposed to be sad, and it's supposed to be frustrating.
You could even see a few little echoes of one of the movies that Rex Harrison made during his little sojourn to America before everything went crazy, Ghost of Mrs. Muir.
Absolutely. Yeah, I really felt that. And that's another movie that is almost great, and just somehow not quite, except he's not the ghost.
No, it's the other way around.
It's the other way around, yeah.
I loved her performance as the ghost. She's great in that ectoplasmic state.
And I guess the way I feel about her performance in this movie is that she manages to fully stand up to this overbearing character that is her husband without kind of being overbearing herself. And a lot of it is just kind of having this sense of humor and sense of irony that she uses to deal with him. And Harrison subtly playing a buffoon who does not have that sense of irony about himself, even though he may direct irony at others.
Yeah, he's incorporated that view of the world that Lilli Palmer really embodies,
right,
once she dies.
And it's the underdog's view of that the wife would develop.
Yeah, so Lilli Palmer, I mean, that is her actress characteristic. One of them, one of the leading ones, has to be, and it ties in with her anti-fascism. She's not going to fight on the same terms as this monolith. She's going to fight her own way.
And for this marriage movie to have this interest, this question behind it of the spiritual bond of marriage, it is important. One of the other movies that we thought about calling a marriage movie in this sense was the Irene and Vernon Castle story, right? It's important that there is an artistic collaboration at the heart of it, even if he is the only one to get credit for it.
Yeah, I think that's right. He can finally join her in death once he finishes his last great masterpiece.
But death turns out to be the eternal return.
The beginning is how it ends. So that is a heartening thought. I've always liked that idea, the eternal return from Nietzsche. We'll see if it's true. Hopefully not too soon. One of the big tour de force scenes, too, I mean, we alluded to it earlier, but should probably mention it. I mean, after the death of the son, when she's clearing out the toys, the camera and the director and Lilli Palmer all work together to create a pretty distressing scene.
Very distressing.
All of those animal toys starting to animate and go crazy as she has a breakdown. And that did take me by surprise. I wasn't expecting the movie to get that phantasmagorical.
Well, yeah, and then it gets even more phantasmagorical. But Maltin does mention what we have not mentioned. There are these long and elaborate animated interludes.
Yeah, those are really cool, and they give you all the context you need. As we mentioned at the beginning of the program, this was a huge week in Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. We saw 5 films, all part of the Alone in the Arena Cinematheque series. We'll go through them, probably not in huge detail. I do want to see how all of these movies impacted you.
Me?
Of course. I've seen all the movies we're going to see from the series. How do you feel about the fact that I got tickets for all of these for us?
They they were all worth watching.
Oh, good. Because we don't discuss this. We leave the cinema and we try to talk about anything but what we've seen so that we can be fresh on the podcast. So
yeah, we just wander the city streets silently a lot of the time and must look like a very strange couple because we're not allowed to talk about the movie that we just saw.
So on the whole, you're glad that we did these five?
Yeah, I was glad to be exposed to them. I don't know or care anything about any sport whatsoever. So the fact that these movies were able to engage me dramatically at all was notable.
That speaks well for the possible universality of the themes explored through sporting events, and that's defined very loosely because Rounders is about poker, not traditionally thought of as a sport, but it's the same kind of idea.
I think the only one that really blew me away was When We Were Kings, which is a documentary, but what a narrative. He Got Game was a weird, weird movie. Spike Lee is a weird, weird writer, but it was interesting. Any Given Sunday had a narrative that's kind of similar to When We Were Kings. By the way, When We Were Kings is a spoilable movie, in my opinion. If you don't know much of anything about Muhammad Ali, but you're interested in Black history, I don't know how you could be interested in Black history but not know anything about Muhammad Ali, but that was the position I was in watching this movie. Way back in the day, I watched Muhammad Ali documentaries, but I didn't remember any details about his life or career.
And you don't think you ever saw this one?
I don't think I ever saw this one.
This is the most famous one.
So if you're in that position, don't listen to us describe this movie because it's actually a spoilable movie. And actually, let's talk about this one first. Because okay. It did make the biggest impact on me. So go and watch this documentary if your knowledge about Muhammad Ali is only vague, but you would like to know more. Because it is spoilable, because I didn't remember for sure who won the fight.
Really?
I was pretty damn sure, not just from general cultural knowledge, but just from the way the movie was setting up this underdog narrative. I was pretty sure that Ali won the fight. But being in the position of not knowing for sure made me actually, of course, the ideal viewer of this movie because it put me in a position vaguely related to the position of the people originally waiting for this fight.
Yeah, Howard Cosell and George Plimpton and Norman Mailer.
And of all of these movies, this is the one where by having this commentary by all those sports journalists who were covering the fight at the time, they describe it, and particularly Mailer describes the strategy of the fight in a way so clear that I could follow it. I mean, that's what the documentary does. It presents step by step along the way as if you don't know what the outcome is going to be, as if it's a surprise. And it was a surprise.
It's too bad. Well, maybe you'll forget by the time we get to Michael Mann's film Ali. All of its narrative thrust is headed towards the conclusion of the Rumble in the Jungle as well. Maybe you would have gotten even more out of that film if you didn't know how this fight ends.
So this was directed and produced by Leon Gast, by the way. By the end, when we're actually watching the fight and Mailer's explaining in real time as to, you know, showing us the fight on the film, how Ali fooled Foreman and the techniques he's using in the ring when his plan A fails. Like, first of all, what his plan A was, and then what he does when the plan A fails. And there's this shot of when he achieves his plan B, which should not have been able to work, there's this shot of the faces of the journalists, and their mouths are agape. They can't believe what he's done. And it's just so incredibly exciting, and to feel like how fucking smart he was and lucky to have pulled this off. Maybe for the first time in my life, I felt the religion of sports. Like, this movie makes you believe in the religion of sports, of what the real excitement of following a sport can be. I'm never going to do it. But for a moment, I could understand it watching this movie. And I mean, I think that makes it a pretty great documentary.
Yeah.
Not to mention there's a lot of pretty interesting political stuff in it.
I saw it, I guess, at the time. It showed in Montreal in the mid-90s. So I saw it, I think, probably at the Cinéma de Paris, which would have shown something like this. I'm not a boxing fan in any way. I had just very basic knowledge of Muhammad Ali. I think I had probably seen him more than anything on, like, Different Strokes or whatever, because he appeared on sitcoms in the 80s. But yeah, it was revelatory. And by then, We already knew George Foreman, too, from being like a goofball on TV, like a sitcom dad. And just to see George Foreman as this, you know, unstoppable monster in the 70s. I mean, the movie really does a good job, you know, amping him up to the level where he just seems like he can't be beaten.
David and Goliath.
And he's pretty funny, too. I mean...
No, he's a great character, and he's almost as good looking as Muhammad Ali.
I mean, Muhammad Ali doesn't think so. He's telling everyone...
I'm gonna beat him because he's ugly! He can't win! He's too ugly!
Yeah, but of course, he'd been using that on everyone that he fought back to the beginning of the 60s. It's an impressive movie, and it brings in all this other stuff that you just can't possibly get in most sports documentaries. All the stuff about what was going on in Zaire at the time.
Real slice of cultural history.
It is. It's a major achievement. Now for the rest of them, let's go through them in the order we saw them. So Rounders, Poker.
Rounders, for me, this movie is stolen by Edward Norton.
Well, that's by design.
His sleazy, rakish charm brings the movie to life every time he is on screen. And it's not even charm, it's like anti-charm. But he's like the most alive thing in the movie. The fact that his character just disappears toward the end, there's no resolution of what is obviously the most important relationship in the movie, that weakened the movie for me.
Really? No, to me, that strengthens it because it's very bold, right? There's no attempt to make it seem like there's a way back. I mean, what he does is fucking forgivable. He gets his friend into serious debt to the point where the Russian mafia is going to kill him. And then he's like, okay, well, we can get this money back by going to play with some municipal workers, a poker game at a bar out in upstate New York. They get there and they're state troopers that they're going to be playing against. And that's one level of betrayal that's insane and would be hard to come back from. Matt Damon goes with it and he's like, okay, well, we have to just win based on skills. We can't do any little magic tricks with the cards. And Edward Norton says, okay, I understand. Just can't help himself. And he gets them pummeled and they lose all the money. And there's no way back from that. I mean, Matt Damon is dead unless Martin Landau is there to bail him out.
And yet Edward Norton is never played, like, it's sort of like Mean Streets, Mean Streets relationship, but in a lesser mode, like in a less heightened mode. Because Edward Norton's character is never portrayed as spectacularly villainous.
No, he's not, right? And I think that's really a great gamut bit of this film that
he seems to be just
an
ordinary fuck up.
Yeah, he can't help it, but there is no way for Matt Damon to continue to go along with him on his journey at that point.
But then the rest, his journey to a ditch.
But I think it's also great that the movie doesn't show that, right? So maybe, who knows where he winds up? It doesn't show us, hey, look, he wound up dead. No, it doesn't show us that. And maybe he doesn't. Maybe he joins the Merchant Marine. Who knows what he's doing?
Sure, but the rest of the movie, you know, Matt Damon finding his vocation as a poker player is just not a great deal of interest to me.
Inherently, no. I like how it plays out. And I love the scenes with Martin Landau. This movie really has some buy-in from some heavyweight character actors. You've got Malkovich doing an insane Laurence Olivier-level Russian gangster.
By the way, I've never watched a string of movies with more
John Turturro. He's everywhere. Yeah. It's too bad that we didn't get Search and Destroy in here.
So should we switch to He Got Game? So this is just a tour de force for Denzel Washington.
Yeah.
Again, playing a character who has done horrible, horrible things, and yet not overplaying the villainy of it.
I think this is one of Spike Lee's best movies.
It's very eccentric.
Well, it certainly is. I don't have any interest in basketball at all. Not a sport I've ever been interested in.
Oh, by the way, a recurring trope of these movies, the ball that goes high up in the air and just spins and spins and spins forever.
I think that's true to the sports fans' experience, right? And probably to the players as well, right? While it's in the air, anything can happen. And then you find out at the end of its trajectory whether it achieves its aim or not.
That's deep.
I really like Ray Allen in this movie, too. I haven't seen it since 1998 when it came out. And in my mind, I'd lost focus on what this movie is because I've I'm a huge Public Enemy fan, and I have the soundtrack album that they did for it. I had forgotten that most of the score is Aaron Copland, which is amazing.
Oh yeah, and it's fantastic.
It's beautifully integrated, and it's Spike Lee, again, doing... I mean, he's trying to make the great American film, always.
I think he's too crazy for that.
Well, I think he kind of succeeds on several occasions throughout his oeuvre.
Also, because I never watch movies from this period, the late 80s and 90s, but I lived through them, so occasionally I caught a movie on TV. Mila Jovovich, fun actress, brave actress, great screen presence, beautiful woman. Wish she'd had more of a career.
Yeah, I agree. Similarly, Famke Janssen.
Yeah.
She was so good.
Very charismatic in Rounders.
I loved her in Rounders.
Not enough screen time.
That's a character role, right? And from what I gathered, she did that deliberately. But it's kind of unfortunate that people mostly know her as Jean Grey in the X-Men movies now. I mean, I'm sure it was good for her career. And she is good in that role to some extent, but those movies are deeply flawed, like all superhero films have been, sadly. But yeah, Ray Allen in He Got Game is a non-actor, and I guess maybe you could tell that, but...
No, not really.
He's really good.
Yeah, no, he managed to be the center of this movie, believably.
I mean, that's hard to do. It's not everyone that can appear on camera and seem like any kind of a human being. Quentin Tarantino can't do it. And this guy, yeah, I mean, he's on camera for almost the whole movie. Goes through a lot and is up to the challenge. I mean, he's acting with Denzel Washington, which can't be an easy thing to handle. He manages to stand up to him really well.
Yeah, and of course, their big scene together at the end does manage to close in on a moment of pathos.
Yeah, I think it's a really impressive film. So you weren't, were you, did it go too far for him to throw the ball over the prison wall?
No, that's not a problem. For me, I was having trouble with, Spike Lee is never a very naturalistic director. Well, sometimes he is. He's a very Brechtian director.
Yes.
But here I felt like the writing was several times more crazy than the filming, and it was giving me some cognitive dissonance, even though the filming was not strictly naturalistic. I wanted the style to match the writing more. That was making me a little crazy. How emotionally invested am I supposed to be in these scenes? Like, they're completely non-credible. They're totally non-realistic, but they're being filmed mostly naturalistically. How do I wrap my head around this? Maybe on a second viewing, that would be less of a problem.
Maybe that's one reason why I don't think this is as great as Bamboozled. Bamboozled is his greatest film. And that's the one where just everything's crazy.
The only failing of the movie for me was that there was a bit of a mismatch between the cinematic style of it and the writing. Writing, which was fully as crazy as a David Lynch film or whatever.
We had two interesting performances or notable performances from Jim Brown in the movies we saw as well. He played one of the, what are they? I don't know, parole officer guys that are following him around in this movie. And he's also in Any Given Sunday as like one of the assistant coaches.
So shall we turn to Any Given Sunday then?
Man, what a great movie. That's Oliver Stone's best movie by far.
It was pretty great. I'll get my one complaint about it out of the way, which is that his editing, his characteristic editing, was fantastic in the football scenes and the behind-the-scenes locker room scenes. His inability to just trust the actors to play a dramatic scene between themselves, though, without stupid, fussy, heavy-handed bullshit interspersing of other material.
Ben-Hur? You didn't like that stuff?
Yeah, that was the most annoying.
Oh, I loved it.
Oh, I hated it. I hated it so much. You love that? Oh, yeah. That was awful. No.
Especially since Ben-Hur is notable for having killed stunt people in the making of those chariot scenes.
Fine, but you don't have to insert it 1 million times while I'm trying to watch a scene between two good actors.
Okay.
Stop. Just stop. Calm down.
I think other people must have commented on this before, but to liken football to the experience in Vietnam is pretty amazing. Oliver Stone obviously is America's great poet of the disaster in Vietnam. He managed to make football even more violent and brutal than Platoon.
Is Oliver Stone to film what Norman Mailer is to novels? I don't know.
I am a football fan. This is the only sport that I care about out of the ones that we saw. I think it really does convey what's going on there, and it certainly makes you feel...
I could not understand understand, unlike the beautifully clear descriptions of boxing strategy and When We Were Kings, I could not for the life of me understand what was going on in these games.
No, that's true. But it might be even more impactful if you don't know how football works.
Total chaos. Yeah. And asking yourself, why would anyone do this?
You got Jim Brown in this movie, who's a coach, right? And he was like one of the great football stars of the 60s. But you have Lawrence Taylor. Lawrence Taylor is so good in this movie. He's the linebacker with the gold teeth who has in danger of dying any minute if he gets the wrong kind of hit. Like, he was great in this movie.
Yeah.
He was an amazing football player and went through a lot. He had a lot of drug problems. But yeah, late 90s here, he had this role, and he also has an amazing moment in The Waterboy where he's talking to kids and then Adam Sandler shows up and talks his crazy water boy talk, and then he's like, and it's like I was saying, kids, don't do drugs. It's so great, the comic timing that he has on that. But in this, there's a lot of pathos there when he's begging to be allowed to play and die and sign a waiver form.
And the structure of the movie, as with When We Were Kings, I mean, is the irresistible structure of the underdog.
And we got Jamie Foxx.
The underdog narrative. What it actually reminded me of is, behind all of the busy editing, it has some very classical Hollywood type tropes familiar from the Backstage musical.
Yeah.
You know, the star gets taken out, so the understudy has to step in. Other types of entertainer movies from that period, the idea that the old forms of entertainment aren't going to cut it anymore, and the pathos of the old entertainer having to give way and make way for the new kind, right? Oh, and also the new kind having to learn the lessons of the old. So yeah, very classic tropes there.
And the stakes are so much higher here, right? Because as the movie shows us, if you're not acting in a coordinated manner in football, people could get killed easily. He really does his damnedest to make it seem indistinguishable from a platoon behind enemy lines in Vietnam. Stakes are that high in this movie.
Right. And again, what would you say to the question the movie raises of why would anybody play this sport?
You know, why do people go to war, right? A lot of the time they're forced to by economic circumstances and other compulsions.
Of course they are, and the movie articulates that.
Yeah.
And, you know, there is the main character,
Jamie Foxx, yeah.
Yeah. He spells out the exploitation of black men in the sport. Of course, by the end, we are made to feel that at least temporarily that is transcended, as they all become a team for the goal of winning and making money.
But the long-term question remains, right? As he raises in his interviews on ESPN or whatever the network is that is running these interviews on the movie, what is there for black athletes after they can't perform on the field anymore? It hasn't gotten much better. Mixed feelings about Oliver Stone in general. Made a lot of movies that I thought were really stupid, like W. But I'm glad you enjoyed it. I thought you might at least like the Al Pacino parts.
Pretty subdued by Al Pacino standards.
It's true, he only has a couple of freakouts. He gets pushed a little hard and driven to some Pacino pyrotechnics by Cameron Diaz.
Yeah, he's an over-the-hill guy who's trying to re-find his place. And he certainly does that by the end.
Yeah, he gets a final fuck you to Cameron Diaz. I mean, she's...
I did love their scenes together. They were pretty great.
She's really good in this movie, too.
Cameron Diaz is okay. 100 other people could have done this role, but...
You know who I thought was great? Elizabeth Berkley. Showgirls. So sadly, Showgirls...
I missed her appearance.
She plays the prostitute. The $5,000 prostitute that hangs out with Al Pacino a couple of times.
Oh, no, that was great, actually.
She was amazing.
When she's trying to seduce him and makes it seem like she's a fan, and then slips him the $1,000 to $5,000 per night.
Exactly. It's such a shame. I mean,
that was a really intense performance.
That's right. She had all the skills to be a star. You know, Showgirls showed us that. But sadly, it also showed Hollywood they didn't want her to ever get a chance to do anything other than bit parts ever again. So I guess that leaves only The Color of Money. Had you seen this before?
I don't think so. It has a reputation of being a lackluster Scorsese film. It's not half the movie that the Rossen film is. And that shouldn't be the case for Martin Scorsese.
Well, Robert Rossen's a great filmmaker.
So is Scorsese. Scorsese, yeah. But this is not half the film.
I agree that it's not one of Scorsese's best. He did come in on it. It wasn't self-generated.
It was Paul Newman generated.
Paul Newman is great.
Paul Newman is great in the movie. Tom Cruise is used in a really interesting way.
Tom Cruise was really terrific in that role. Yeah. Mary Elizabeth Mastrantonio. Another one who really, she didn't become nearly as big as she should have been.
Yeah, it's not a great genre for women's roles. Yeah, Tom Cruise, it's so interesting because...
Vince.
Because Paul Newman's character in The Hustler at the beginning of the movie is a cocky asshole, but he's not a flake, which is what Tom Cruise is playing.
Right, well, of course, we meet Paul Newman once he's already become a hustler. He's running a con game with his partner at the beginning of that film. So you get a sense that this is what Paul Newman might have been like before that, right?
I guess.
That's got to be how you look at this movie, that we're seeing the prehistory of the Paul Newman character in The Hustler.
Apparently, a lot of those shots were in fact pulled off by Cruise and Newman, who really took to the sport.
What does it all mean? I mean, we're not here to discuss it the way that we talk about the main events of our podcast. So Fear and Moviegoing is supposed to be just a quick hit. Does it rob The Hustler of its poignancy, or is it some kind of a satisfying conclusion to that saga? How do you feel?
No.
Not satisfying?
Not satisfying. No, not at all. Like, not even by the standards of him finding his way back to the game. It's just not, stakes aren't even there as they were laid out in the first movie.
It's a very apolitical film.
Yeah, we were set up by the person who introduced it to think that this was going to be some kind of major takedown of greed and corruption in the 80s. Not by Scorsese standards. It's a soulless movie, maybe.
I don't think it's a soulless movie. I think it's maybe too soulful in a way, right? Like, it's too focused on the individual. What it's saying is that Paul Newman, through this weird journey that he has in this film, gets his soul back by, he somehow manages to transcend the whole relationship of pool player to gambler, right? He tries out being George C. Scott, realizes that that's too horrible to contemplate, to continue doing that, and he finds his way back to just actually loving playing pool, and that's epiphany.
Yeah, of course it is, but like I said, by the stakes of what that meant in the first movie about him as an artist, I just don't feel the weight of that in this movie.
Well, no, how could you? Because it's saying that, yeah, the artist can be fulfilled without getting caught up in the capitalist matrix, and I don't think that that's true, but that's what the movie is saying. It's saying that you can...
Yeah, not only is the central relationship from the first movie absent, and nothing takes its place, but not even the relationship between Tom Cruise and Paul Newman. Not even close. Although that's the closest we get to some kind of relationship, important relationship forming in this movie. But yeah, it also just completely jettisons the critique of capitalism from the first movie. So what's left?
Yeah, it tries to sidestep it anyway, or tries to heal it in a way that's only satisfactory at the personal level. And it is nice to see Paul Newman happy again at the end of the movie, but that's not a way forward for all of us.
Like, if we were thinking of it as an allegory in the same terms set out by the first movie, what would this allegory be? I can make an indie movie? What is the allegory?
Yeah, I think that's all it could be. Anyway, I'm glad that we saw all of those. And 8 more movies already scheduled for the Cinematheque in the next month or so. So they're doing a pretty good job of enticing us back to the cinema.
That's not what it was, but we're enjoying it.
Next week on the podcast, Hollywood Studios Year by Year, 1945, 20th Century Fox. We'll be doing Fallen Angel by Otto Preminger and Leave Her to Heaven by John Stahl.
So, oh, that ought to be juicy.
I don't see how that can fail to be a scintillating podcast. See you then.